Hello, I'm Dr. Dennis McKenna. Welcome to another edition of Inside Albany Med. And I'm always happy to have guests join us today. James Brisbin is here. James, it's great to have you here.
Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure.
Now, James, you are the manager of the Aramark Career Center here at Albany Med. We're going to talk about that.
Great.
But I think for people watching this video right now, you're a familiar face. They've seen you around. I think, you know, I've known you and known about your work here. I think it's incredible. And I think others are going to be as inspired as I am by the work you do here. So let's jump right in. First of all, the Career Center here at Albany Med. Tell me a little bit about what its role and function is.
Well, initially when I arrived here, it was called the Staffing Center. But soon after, you know, working with Jay Matrick and Stephanie DeBacco, we decided to change the name to Career Center because really it kind of evolved. It went from, you know, filling open positions to actually building careers for people.
And let's back up. You weren't always employed by Aramark. You had a different role, used to interact with Jay and others, and then ultimately moved here. So why don't we go back a little bit, talk about the work you used to do, and then maybe transition to the work you do now.
Okay. Well, for about the last 20 years, I've worked with refugees and immigrants from a Christian viewpoint. I had a church with that was mostly Burmese, and from that point I actually got a job working with USCRI, which is United States Committee for Refugees and Immigrants. Okay. Really the religious part and the resettlement part kind of worked very well together, because a lot of people in my congregation, they would arrive, they needed jobs, I helped them get jobs, and I kind of evolved into that, and then I became active in that resettlement part. And when I did that for USCRI, it was, again, jobs that I fell into. So yeah. it became my specialty.
And you said at one point you would work closely with Jay Matarak when he was here. He's still here at Albany Med, but he was in a different role. And you would often bring refugees or immigrants here as potential employees of Albany Med. And eventually you moved into the role that Jay used to have here at Albany Med. Is that correct?
Absolutely right. Yeah. Yep. When I worked for USCRI, we had a lot of partnerships with different organizations in the community. And of course, Albany Med was one we really wanted to be active with, and I began to work with Jay and bring him candidates, and he would interview them, and we'd get some placements going, and we probably worked together 4 years in that capacity before Jay said, "Hey, I'm getting promoted. How would you like a job?"
Fall into the job that he did. This gives me an opportunity to reemphasize things that I've said many times in the past. So first of all, we know Albany Med is the largest private employer in the Capital Region. We know proudly that we hire and employ people that come from probably the most diverse background of any employer in the area. I believe I've been told from over 80 different home origin countries.
Absolutely true.
And also the importance that I emphasize of every member of our team, whether they be clinical or non-clinical, whether they work in the hospital or one of our offsite locations, it takes all of those almost 10,000 employees to make Albany Med what it is, the only academic medical center in the area. And you play a really important part, James, as far as bringing into to our workforce individuals who come from some of those backgrounds. So talk about what you do and how you bring them in to be part of our workforce here.
Well, I think being involved for 20 years in refugee and immigrant services, people often come to me. And I think maybe one of the biggest surprises is that the recruiting we do with the Aramark with Career Center are mostly referrals, are mostly right. People who know me, who got a job with me, or have a sister who works here. So although Aramark has a way of posting jobs and attracting new talent, a lot of it is just people who have worked here, love to work here, and want their relatives to work here, and it's a word of mouth. Occasionally we have to reach out, but it's rare.
About 2 weeks ago, you and I had a chance to participate in an event that we have every year here in September, National Citizenship Day. It was a lovely event. You gave some wonderful remarks. I took the opportunity to talk about how it was really three different stories in one, right? It's the story of the individual who comes here from another country and makes a life for themselves. It's a story about Albany Med and Aramark working together to provide meaningful employment for those individuals. And it's a story about America, which is welcoming and says, you know, this is a place of opportunity for you. And you were saying that recently one of the employees mentioned the USA and what that meant to them.
Yeah, it was kind of interesting. He asked me, did I know what USA stood for? And I thought for sure I did. But he had a different twist on it when I said United States of America. And he said, no, it means you start again.
You start again.
And he didn't, it was not in a negative way. It was in a way of acceptance. He had had a degree, and he was going for a job, maybe patient transport or something along that lines. But we went on to have a longer conversation about opportunity and stepping stones, and that he was free here.
And whether you come to Albany Med from Albany itself, Bethlehem, Niskayuna, maybe you come here from Burma or Nepal or India. There are opportunities to grow in our organization. We've profiled here on these videos Anissa, who obviously came in and was a hallway greeter, and then she worked in the information booth, and then she now is a manager over, I think, 50 different individuals.
Yes.
We recently profiled at our Albany Med Cares Award, Monica.
Yeah.
Who is obviously won our Albany Med Cares Award. There are many individuals that we could reference who came in here and are moving up and taking on additional responsibility. It's not just about entry-level positions, it's about career opportunities.
Right. People who see the big picture are very successful here, and where, part of my job is showing them the big picture. And it's not making up fairy tales. Right. It's really is true. I have seen so many people who I've hired in their first position, maybe as a PSA or EVS, and they climb that ladder. Right. And I'll see them 4 years and I'll say, where are you working now? Oh, I'm an ASA on D4, right. And it's a wonderful thing.
And some have even gone on to become clinical roles, nurses.
Absolutely. We have actually, there's this wonderful young lady who she became a PSA right during COVID.
Right.
And she was so scared and she was so nervous and she didn't know if she could do the job. And she would come back with wonderful stories of, oh, James, I was able to help this person. I was able to do that. This nurse thanked me for the work I did. Now she's a PCA, and she says, James, I want to be part of the homegrown program.
That's great.
I want to become a nurse. And she is a very talented young lady.
Wonderful.
And healthcare is for her.
One of the barriers, of course, that people who face sometimes is language. And one of the things I'd like you to talk to a little bit about is your role specifically in our English as a Second Language program. We're sitting in a classroom here, maybe we'll show some photos of it, of signs on the walls and the ways in which you teach the individuals English as a second language. And that's gotta be very challenging to do. You were describing sometimes you may have 12 different individuals in one classroom who may speak 10 different languages, yet you're teaching them all at the same time. Just describe, if you can, how do you do that?
Sometimes it's a little bit more difficult than others, but as long as they're on the same, what's really hard is that when you're trying to teach an advanced student and you have an intermediate beginner, that's right. When it's difficult. But if you have, they're basically on the same level, then it goes pretty well, because in English class you speak English, and people have that base, and they're, what you're trying to do is increase that base. When I first started teaching ESL, I had no idea what an absolute joy it would be. How exciting. I mean, people are excited to learn English,
right.
They're excited to know more, they're excited when they have a breakthrough, and I'm excited.
So you just use the word breakthrough. I bet you have those moments in class where they start to put words together, form sentences, actually think in English, and then now they can be more successful, not only in their job, maybe it opens up new opportunities for them here, and also obviously outside of work as well.
Absolutely. I have one young lady who was referred to me, and she was having a difficult time writing a professional email.
Right.
And just seeing in a 12-week period her initial English samples, writing samples,
right.
To now, it is just, it's amazing. Wow. And you know, you feel so proud that, that they have achieved so much in such a short time.
That's a credit to you. That's great.
Well, it's very rewarding work.
I'm sure it is.
And you know, if we could take a step back, 2 years ago, we didn't have an ESL program.
Okay.
And, you know, every time I brought it up, because it is something very close to my heart, they would say, we don't have a room yet, and you know, the who taught it before, there's minimums and there's stuff involved. And I finally said to Stephanie DeBacca, from Aramark, Stephanie, can I just go back to school? Can I get my certification? I want to do it. I can do it. She goes, sure. And Aramark foot the bill. Stephanie allowed me extra time to do some studying, and in a year I was certified.
Fantastic.
So
fantastic.
And then right into it, and it's been great. And I can't tell you how supportive the people are around me. I mean, not Aramark, Albany Med. They've been really supportive of this program and you know, some of the ideas that I've come up with.
Wonderful. Let's talk a little bit about what you like to do outside of work. I know that you said you have a passion for music. What particular type of music is your interest?
Well, I've been collecting vinyl records since I was 13.
Okay.
I have two record players in my house and no TV and about 8,000 records.
So, is that right?
Yes, I love vinyl records. My favorite musical artist is Bob Dylan. I got a great story. I don't know if it's too long about that, but
try it. Give it to us. give us the clip over.
Bob Dylan played at Proctor's, and okay. and I was on the internet and I was trying to get a ticket, and you know, something went wrong and my ticket was thrown out of my basket. And before I could get back in the basket, you know, the checkout gone, sold out. And the secondary ticket market, so 1,200, 800, because Proctor's small place, Bob Dylan, a legend, 83 years old.
Right.
Who knows how long we're going to have Bob with us. So, day of the show, I made a sign. One ticket, please. And I said my prayers, and I went down to Proctor's. And Jay is also, Jay Madrick is also, you know, my buddy with music. And he was away at the time, and I would send him pictures of me with my sign, and I wasn't getting any action. And finally, about half hour before the show, someone walks up to look at my sign. They said, throw that away. I got you. I said, what? Get rid of the sign. I said, really? I said, how much? He goes, don't worry about it. Well, I did worry about it. I held on to my sign. I put it in my pocket, but I wasn't sure. But miracles happen. And guy gave me a ticket, walked in the door, went down to find my seat. Lady goes, no, center, center. And then down, seventh row.
Wow.
It was a miracle.
All right.
It was absolute miracle. I believe in miracles. And I got to see Bob Dylan for the first time and being a fan for the last 50 years.
That story didn't take too long, and it was worth hearing. Okay. And it was worth hearing. One other question about your record collection. So 7,000. So if I was to hold up any one of the 7,000, would you be able to identify the record and the songs on it?
Maybe where I bought it, who gave it to me.
Really?
You know, really, I think...
Almost an eidetic memory of your music collection.
I think music is a timestamp. And so my children also think that. They'll say, Dad, I remember you playing this in the car on the way to the baseball games.
Really?
Really, you know, music is really, really important to me. And yeah.
And you mentioned one other thing. You said that you believe in miracles, and I know that you have a ministerial life outside of work as well.
Yes. I'm an Anglican priest, and I've been a priest for about the last 15 years. And that really was part of what got me into refugee and immigrant ministry, because the church I was assigned to had basically mostly Burmese refugees who arrive in this country as baptized Christians. The subgroups Karini and Karin are baptized Christians, and when they arrived here, they needed a church to go to. And at one point, we had 125 parishioners, and about 111 of them were Burmese.
Wow!
But I think the wonderful thing, getting back to the Career Center, the wonderful thing about this job is it dovetails into so many things that were unexpected. I mean, certainly my faith is a part of what I do here. my work with refugees is what a part of it. And also, you know, we talk a lot about refugees and immigrants in the Career Center, but it's broader than that.
Right.
It's anyone who needs an opportunity and who thinks that healthcare might be for them. So really, I mean, that's the beautiful thing about Albany Med is it gives so many people opportunities to a career who maybe wouldn't have one. You know, you compare this entry-level position, entry-level jobs, to other entry-level jobs, and you have a ceiling here.
Right.
Here, really, I mean, if you're willing to work hard, if you do a good job, if you are called to healthcare, and a lot of people are not called to healthcare, really, the sky is the limit. You can achieve almost anything here. And I'm very proud of that fact that Albany Medical Center has opened its arms to so many. And so many have been successful.
Well, I like to say I believe it's a very special place. It has a very special mission. In order to do that, we need very special people. I think you're one of them. It's really a wonderful story. I'm glad you took the time to spend a little time educating me and the workforce about the work that you do here with the Career Center, English as a second language, and your work with our populations, both immigrant and refugee. So thank you so much, James.
Thank you.